Crafting an Effective Mobile Marketing Strategy, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. My name is Kara Tyrone, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Lauren Epshteyn, Advertising Strategist at Google and published author. Before we begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded for the YouTube channel. Simply go to youtube.com and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services or click on the link in the chat area to check out videos of over 375 past sessions. There are two audio options for today's webinar. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you are more than welcome to use one. It is important to note, if you experience audio difficulties using your speakers, this can be caused by having too many software apps open. Feel free to close some of those applications or simply join us via the conference line provided on the control panel and in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen as you have them. The presenter is planning to answer as many questions as time allows during the Q&A portion of the presentation. PowerPoint slides will also be emailed to you following today's webinar. And finally, if you have any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area or visit the GoToWebinar support page. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter. Lauren Epshteyn is an advertising sales strategy executive at Google, where she leads the East Coast Multiscreen Performance Marketing Team. She's a frequent speaker and panelist on the state and future of mobile marketing. Previously, Lauren led Google's retail vertical account management team, consulting with over 100 top-tier national retail accounts over the course of 6 years. In addition to her work on the performance marketing team, Lauren heads the regional industry relations team for North America, creating partnerships between Google and community stakeholders in the advertising, tech, and entrepreneurship communities. She is an active member of several service organizations, including New York Cares, through which she participates in education and nutrition counseling for underprivileged teens. She also serves on the board of the Newman Laca Cancer Foundation and the Mentorship Committee Board for Advertising Women of New York. MBA with a specialization in marketing and entrepreneurship and innovation from NYU's Stern School of Business. Lauren, thank you again for your time today, and now I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Kara, and thank you to everyone on the line who's joining live today, and thank you to everyone who will watch later on your own time. It's a pleasure to be here with you. Kara just took us through some of the salient points of my resume and why you may stick around to hear me talk about mobile marketing, but I thought I'd just share a few things. This is a picture of me, and this is a picture of Georgetown, a place many of you probably recognize from your own pasts. I was a 2007 grad. I loved my time at Georgetown. I actually loved Washington, D.C. more than any other place I'd spent time, so I decided to write a book about it. When I was a junior at Georgetown, I published a book called, wrote and published a book called Where to Date in D.C. A few things you may note about the cover here. One, it's a bit amateur, but it was a really fun project in college, and we sold quite a few copies. The book takes you through 75 fun things to do in, 75 restaurants in Washington and 25 fun things to do without eating. You also may notice that I now have the same last name that my co-author did then, and we dated so much in D.C. that we ended up getting married after we moved to New York. So shortly after I published the book, I ended up with a job at Google, where I've been for the last almost 9 years. It's been a great leadership role working with retail advertisers. And then more recently, about 2 years ago, I switched over to our mobile marketing team, where I work with Fortune 500 advertisers across verticals. So if there are any of you out there who have a business that has nothing to do with retail, no problem. I'm happy to answer questions for you, too. We advise on what mobile sites and apps should and can look like in a perfect world. We talk about mobile media choices, and we talk about measuring the impact of the improvements that you make to both your site and your media. And that's what I'm going to take you through today. So just two more things about myself. As Kara mentioned, I did go to NYU. I like to say that Georgetown is first in my heart, though, but I do have a business degree from NYU. And then most recently, I wrote a book, which is a novel, unlike the Where to Date in D.C., which was a nonfiction regional travel guide. A Northern Gentleman is available on Amazon and in select bookstores. So I hope all of you will check it out. It's a fast-paced read, historical fiction about a guy who's bored with his job, so he runs away to figure out what he really wants to do with his life. And because the year is 1890, he's able to reinvent himself and figure out what he wants to do with his life from the perspective of a totally different identity everywhere he goes. So it's a lot of fun. It's getting some good feedback. Would love if you check it out on Amazon. Speaking of last names on the covers of books, this one I used a pen name for. So don't be surprised if you see Lane Everett on the cover of that one. And so without further ado, let's get into mobile marketing. So when we talk about mobile marketing, talk about friction and how important the reduction of friction is to any sort of really marketing effort, but also just the forward movement of technology. When I talk about the reduction of friction, I often use the example of, think about, I believe it was Wells Fargo who first introduced the concept that not only do you not have to go into a bank and talk to a teller to deposit a check, but you don't even have to interact with an ATM. Why not just take a picture of that check on your phone and deposit it remotely? And that was the ultimate example of reduction of friction because it completely set the bar for what all other competitors or banks, you know, in the industry had to do to keep their customers happy. People expected now that they could deposit checks remotely, and if they couldn't, it was considered a friction point. You can think through friction in another way. Think about if you need to accomplish any task, let's say you need to send a text message, more than likely you need to take out your phone, you know, make sure that you've plugged in your password, open the text messaging app. But some companies, Google included, have said, what if we reduced each of those tiny points of friction, the reaching into your pocket and taking out the phone as a point of friction, and said, no, what if you just wore that technology? You text message via a watch that you don't even need to reach into your pocket for, or potentially via glasses that you wear on your face and you can just talk to. So some of these ventures in technology have worked out better than others, obviously, but the idea here is, as a marketer, you should be looking for ways that you can reduce friction for your customers, right? Think about perhaps what you might do to reduce friction for grandma who's trying to figure out how to use their remote control. Just simplify, simplify, simplify. There's so many buttons that are going to confuse her and throw her off. If your website, or even worse, your mobile web site or app, has all of these extraneous buttons that no one really needs to use, then you need to think about removing friction for your customers. And sometimes we talk about how advertisers and marketers are inadvertently creating friction for themselves. Oftentimes this is related to a topic that we'll talk about later in the hour, but how are you organized? If your marketing department has mobile marketing completely separated out from the rest of the marketing department, perhaps, frankly, I talked to some very large companies that have just one or two people assigned to be the mobile marketing folks, then you're creating frictions and tensions within your own company. And we're going to talk about some ways that you can smooth that out later in the hour. So I have a feeling that I may be preaching to the choir when I share this stat, but when we look at 2015, average time spent per U.S. adult in the United States, we see that digital was second only to TV in 2011. But by 2015, that number had grown substantially, and it was driven entirely by time spent with mobile. Right? So now digital is the number one media form that is interacted with in terms of time per day by U.S. adults. And just to recap, all of that growth driven by time spent with mobile. That's an additional 3 hours per day. So we're so dependent on our mobile devices that there's this concept of nomophobia, right? Who has left the house without their phone and realized they needed to go, no matter how far they had gotten, needed to go back and get it, right? It's the only piece of technology, most likely. May even be the only thing you carry around in a day, maybe with the exception of your keys, but it's the only type of media that you would go back for. You would not go back if you forgot your newspaper at home, right? So talk about nomophobia. How long do you think it takes the average person to report a lost wallet? Well, these days, frankly, I don't even know how many people carry around a wallet anymore. I personally have switched over to just carrying the 3 credit cards that I need physically in a little pouch that is taped or, you know, has some adhesive, holding it to the back of my phone. So all I need to carry around is my phone and these cards. And more, I'm paying through apps anyway, which eliminates the need for cards. But a study by Unisys found that the average time to report a lost wallet is 26 hours. However, to report a lost phone, or at least to start freaking out about it, just over an hour. So that is just one more proof point that Americans, at least, have come to view the mobile phone as a part of their body, a part of their identity. And so for marketers, this is an incredibly important and powerful device to interact with the consumer on and to answer their questions and to add value to their life. So the idea here is that we don't go online anymore. We live online, right? You don't say, I'm going to go on the internet. You just quickly pull out your phone and Google the answer to a question. Maybe you're having a debate over dinner and you want an answer at your fingertips. Now you have your mobile phone to do it. So what are the implications here? Well, there are so many different moments in a day that a consumer interacts with their phone, right? There's texting your friend or family. There's posting pictures online. Now, these are moments where you're interacting with your phone. But I want to differentiate between moments and what we at Google call micro moments, which are the intent-rich moments where you're not just posting something or checking an email or communicating with a friend, but you're looking for something. You want an answer. You want to know where to have brunch or how to choose the right running shoes or how to tie a bow tie, something that I have Googled incessantly as my husband and I prepare for some events. So these are the moments, these micro moments, are the ones that are perfect for marketers to step in and say, you know, hey, we have some information that can make your life easier. When I talk about adding value to the life of the consumer, I mean giving them shortcuts and making it easy for them to find the information that they need, making all that information easily discoverable, and at the same time, positioning your brand as a great place to get that information or ultimately to complete a conversion if that's what you offer. So just to recap, a micro moment is a moment when we act on a need, whether that's to learn something, do something, or discover or buy something, right? It's that intent-rich moment, which is different than when you're just standing in line, wasting time, scrolling through a news feed, or texting a friend, right? There are times when marketers should stay quiet and stay out of the conversation, and then there are times when the consumer invites the marketer in, and these are micro moments. So we've given quite a bit of thought at Google to what are the types of micro moments that are most prevalent, and I want to introduce you to 5 of them. There are the top of the funnel, I want to watch what I'm into moments, and you should know that 53% of online video viewers watch online video just to be inspired or entertained, right? Sometimes it's okay to interact with consumers without driving home the point that you're trying to sell them something. YouTube is a good place to do that. It's the number one platform for young people to explore their passions through video, but it's also the number 2 search engine in the world, second only to Google. If you're moving down the purchase funnel slightly, you'll move into those I want to know moments, right? These people are ready to, they're the influence consideration bucket. They're ready to find out more, to compare their options. We know that 65% of consumers look up more information online now than they did a year ago. 2/3 of smartphone users turn to their phones to look up something they saw on a TV commercial. So if any of you out there are invested in TV advertising, mobile advertising is an important piece of completing that picture of marketing. The I want to go moments, this is the near me. Near me searches have doubled in the last year, and 82% of smartphone users have used a search engine when looking up a local business. So it's, if you have a local business concern, then you definitely need to be thinking about mobile advertising. This is the way that people will find you now. It's no longer just about, oh, the store that I pass on my way home. People will be using their smartphone to find not only where you're located, what are your hours, can they call you with just the tap of a button directly from the search results, but also what do you have in stock and how close are you exactly. And Google has an offering called location ads that will allow you to give all that information directly in the search results. So there's the what I want to do moments, and 91% of smartphone users turn to their phones for ideas when actually completing a task. This is the how to do it moments, how do I fix it moments. 100 million plus hours of how-to content has been watched on YouTube, and this is in a given year, so not so far in 2016, but in a given year. And then for I want to buy moments, these are the customers who are the farthest down the purchase funnel. They know that they're ready to buy what you're selling, and there's been a 29% increase in mobile conversion rates in the past year. So for those of you who've heard or believe that mobile phones are really a great research device, no question about it. Conversion rates are still stronger on desktop. In fact, conversion rates on desktop are getting ever stronger as people are doing their research and all of those visits on their mobile phone and then going to their desktop just to finish off the conversion. But there's also been, at the same time, an increase in mobile conversion rates. So what does this mean? How has mobile changed our society? Well, in three ways. One, mobile has made us expect immediate action, right? We want to know the answer right now. We don't want to waste our time with extra clicks, extra taps on the screen. We want the answers at our fingertips, and that includes the ability to call, to download an app, to do whatever it is, to find directions, all, you know, within max 1 to 2 taps. And so definitely encourage you to include as much of that information right in the search results. And I'll have a slide in just a moment about how you can do that. We have high expectations, and that comes down to relevance in search ads, but also frictionless experiences when it comes to mobile sites and apps as well. Frictionless experiences as in big, easy to click buttons, no extraneous buttons, form fill. I believe we'll talk about this in just a moment, but you want to eliminate as many unnecessary fields as possible because consumers have high expectations that have been set, frankly, by those brands that everyone knows these days as having changed the way we live, brands like Uber, brands like Airbnb that understand how to use the native functionality of a smartphone to make things easy on the consumer. And ultimately, mobile phones have changed our view on decisions in terms of making it much easier to make an unscripted decision. People are more loyal to their need in the moment than to a given brand, and they're impatient. And if a brand is not providing the experience or the speed that they need on a mobile phone, they'll turn to a competitor. So, how can you as a marketer succeed in a micro-moment world? Well, we break it into four buckets. Be there, be useful, be quick, and connect the dots. And I'll walk you through each of these. Let's start with be there. Make sure that your brand is in the selection set. So many consumers are not brand committed. In fact, we know that 51% of smartphone users have discovered a new company or product when conducting a search on their smartphones, which means that if you're a brand, perhaps a smaller brand or a brand that isn't as well known, then you need to make sure that you are there. And when I say there, I mean present in the search results when people are looking for either you or your competitor or what you sell, or perhaps even a step before that. What are those trigger stimuluses? Actually, just this morning I was with a finance services advertiser who is in the personal loan space, and we spent time brainstorming what are the moments that precede when someone realizes that they need a loan, right? So you want to think about what comes before someone is even looking for you and be present there as well. One in three smartphone users have purchased from a company or brand other than the one that they were seeking because of the information that they were provided in that moment. And ultimately, showing up in mobile search ads can result in increased unaided brand awareness. And we've seen that in several studies that we've conducted. So how can you do this? How can you make sure that you are there for the moments that matter? Well, we talked about micro moments already, right? My recommendation is that you ask yourself some questions about your consumer. Who is your audience? What does a day in their life look like? What are the questions they're asking themselves as they move along that purchase funnel that ultimately will make them a customer of yours? And try and think about them in terms of micro moments, right? Is it, I want to walk and be entertained? Is it, I've just left a doctor's appointment and I have some bad news and I need to do some searches to figure out what that means? That could be important for pharma advertisers or OTC, or which is over-the-counter, or financial services advertisers. Or maybe you've got some great news. A new grandchild's on the way, or a wedding is being planned, right? You want to think about what are these moments that are sending people to their search engines as they're on the go, or even, frankly, while they're at home, more and more mobile phones are being used completely interchangeably with laptop and desktop and tablet. One example of thinking through a micro moment is what Red Roofin did. They thought about their customers as often being stranded at airports, finding out that their flight was canceled or delayed, and they thought about a looks like I'm staying the night moment, right? And they decided that they wanted to own the search results whenever someone needed a hotel near the airport. And so that's what they did. And look at this mobile search result. They include a lot of information. They have a lot of what we call extensions. The ability to call, it's a call extension. It's just a tap on that button. They have review extensions. That's where they get the 3.7 stars out of 5. Obviously, you'd prefer to have closer to 5, but hey, they're honest about it and they at least provide that information. Site links, which is the find and in, Red Roof Plus, etc., that will deep link you or the user directly into that page of the site. And then they also have the location extensions, which will provide directions to the nearest locations. Be useful. It's actually not enough to just be there. You need to provide utility. 73% of consumers say that regularly getting useful information from an advertiser is the most important attribute when selecting a brand. 51% of smartphone users have bought from a brand other than the intended one. We talked about a stat like that earlier. And then 61% of smartphone users say that they're more likely to buy from companies who customize mobile information to their location. And I think I misspoke earlier when I said location ads. Location inventory ads is the name of the product I was trying to mention earlier. If any of you are retailers, really of any size out there, local inventory ads allows you to have a feed into your in-store inventory that will allow you to say right in the search results the price, if it's in stock, how close the nearest store that has a product in stock is. So that's an important way to customize information based on location. So the best advice I can give you about enhancing your mobile ads with extensions is, when it's appropriate, try to include at least a couple of the following. If you have an app, make sure you have an app extension. An app extension is just a small little text link below your ad that will allow people with just one tap to download your ad. You only pay if they do click on your ad or download the app, and it will not trigger unless they have a phone that is compatible with the app but do not have the app installed already. Call extensions, so critical. If you accept calls, have a call extension. A phone has a native capability of making a phone call. Allow people to do that easily. Don't make them go to your site in order to make a call to you. And then location extensions. That's what you see down at the very bottom of the page where it has the address, and then you click and it will link to a map, which, of course, on Google Maps has directions from where they are. You can also pump up your click-through rate with these tactics. You definitely want to be at the top of the page when at all possible, over the summer, Google made a change where now we have 3 ads on mobile devices, but there's not always 3. Sometimes there's 1, 2, maybe even no ads. You definitely want to try and be at the top of the page because we know that the top spot receives 75% of the ad clicks. And by the way, Capital One on the left there has an app extension, and it says that the app is free to download. We know that those click-to-call buttons, which are critically important, add up to 8% bump in click-through rate, which is a huge click-through rate bump for anyone who's familiar with search. And then those site link extensions, which I mentioned earlier, a smaller bump on average in click-through rate, but what a good experience if you know what you're looking for and you can go directly to that page in the site. So critical. You really want to shoot in terms of site experience to have people find what they're looking for within 2, max 3 taps. And then important, a little harder, but still extremely important, is empowering your users or customers to convert across device. And when I say across device, I mean to start the research process on their mobile phone, realize that they want to complete the purchase on their desktop, and to do that seamlessly and very easily. Same goes for, frankly, empowering purchases that may happen in store or via a call center. And one way that we would recommend doing that is having a button where someone, if they've started filling out a form, can email to themselves all the information or email themselves product information if they wanted to call, you know, call center or a sales rep and complete the purchase over the phone. If you can get information about signed-in users, making it extremely easy for them to sign in across devices and to complete the purchase on their laptop or another device. Extremely important because we do know that even though conversion rates on mobile phones have gone up about 29%, as I mentioned earlier, the majority of conversions are still happening on laptop and desktop. It's just, it's what people are used to. It's often an easier experience. And frankly, the site experiences are differentiated enough that people are still incentivized to complete that purchase on their desktop because it's often so much easier. Be quick. So 40% of customers say they'll abandon a site that takes over 3 seconds to load. And almost 30% of smartphone users will immediately switch to another site or app if it's too clumsy or slow. I'm laughing because I had an experience like this earlier today, and I feel like I often do. But when an app is not performing the way that it should, it really makes you think about that brand and if you want to continue your loyalty to that brand. It certainly has. And one that, so one nice thing that we can offer you is that there are 2 publicly available websites that I recommend that can really help you determine what is the speed of our mobile website and what can we do about it. So I would recommend checking your company's page speed load time and how you can improve it. I have the link listed here. You can also just Google Page Speed Insights, Page Speed Insights, and plug in your site, and it will give you a score out of 100. Frankly, if you're in the 70s or 80s, that's pretty good. And the tool also gives you concrete suggestions that you can pass on to your developers about how to improve the speed of the site. There's also a tool that I've discovered recently called webpagetest.org. Where you can make a call out, and when I say a call out, you can have the tool call out via servers to, let's say, an Android device to see how long it takes your site to load, and you can get all sorts of interesting information, again, that you can then pass on to your developers. Generally, we like to say make sure that your site is fully loaded in 10 seconds or less. Part of speed is not just how fast your site is loading, but also, how quickly can someone complete what they came to your site to do in the first place? 67% of smartphone users who switch to another site or app will do so it takes too many steps to purchase. Now, some of the culprits of this I've seen time and time again, and actually, frankly, I see it just as often, if not more often, on desktop sites. advertisers asking for city, state, and zip code, when really providing a zip code will, at a minimum, provide the state, also the city usually. Or sometimes advertisers will say, what type of credit card do you have, and then ask for the number. But if you plug in the number, the system will know what type of credit card you have. It's based on the first several numbers of the credit card. So you definitely want to try and eliminate steps whenever possible. One way to do that is to implement one-click functionality, even if that's not about one-click purchase, but just to say, give us your email address, click here, and then we'll be able to, communicate with you later on. We don't need you to do an entire form fill right now. If you do have a form fill, try and make them as efficient as possible. Number pad is something that far too many advertisers overlook. If you need a year, definitely provide a number pad rather than a drop down. I see so many drop downs on mobile phones that start in 1900 for a birth year or 2016 for a birth year. Unlikely that someone is in either of those, and then you're forced to scroll to your correct year. Just pop up a number pad. In fact, any field that requires numbers should have a number pad and not the QWERTY keypad. And then provide alternatives to finish that transaction, saying, do you want to check out as a guest? Do you want to finish on another device? Just give us your email address. That's all we need. We'll email it to you. You definitely want to think through, how can we make this as easy and quick for the customer and to reduce all of those points of friction? You also want to anticipate their needs. A great way to do this is to put calls to action for primary activities in a prominent spot. Don't bury them down on the site. You are all familiar with the concept of below the fold. Sometimes important actions are buried in menus. I would definitely recommend, if there's one action that you want them to take, put it front and center on the site. But then also have information for people across the purchase funnel, people who may be not even sure that they want or need your product yet, all the way through to those people who are in the influence consideration bucket, to those who are ready to purchase or make a conversion of some kind, to those who have already done so and already are, brand loyalists or are regular customers. I also can't stress enough how important it is to take advantage of built-in capabilities of mobile phones, like GPS, like the ability to text, like the ability to make a phone call, like the ability to take a picture. If it's possible to work in any of these functionalities to improve the site experience or the app experience that you're offering, I would highly recommend it. Remember that at the end of the day, a mobile phone has so many more capabilities than a desktop. And from an advertising perspective, we have the ability to tell you what type of device they're on. So take advantage of that information. If you know they're on a mobile phone, make sure you have a location extension if you have a physical location. Or if you accept phone calls, make sure that you have the ability for them to just tap once on the call extension button to get in touch with you. And then you also want to use customers' past behavior, autofill, to the extent that you can use. We have something called the Chrome autofill beta, where if a customer is logged into Chrome and they have chosen to allow Chrome to know their form fill regular choices, that it can autofill into a mobile form. Google also did a survey where we looked at hundreds of users and how they use their mobile devices, both Android and iOS, across hundreds of sites, and we asked them for, what made it a great site experience. And we bucketed their answers into five groups. And we'll make sure that you get this as a takeaway. But there are 25 practices that we recommend that, whenever appropriate, every marketer takes into account to make their site experience as frictionless as possible. And they range from having site search visible near the top of the page down to not needing to pinch and zoom, or not needing to reorient the phone if you're holding it portrait versus landscape. Lots of really good nuggets here, so I definitely would recommend either checking back to when this webinar is posted for this, or you can just Google 25 principles of mobile site design, and you'll easily find this one cheater. The last piece today is about connecting the dots. So we know that people purchase across screens. We talked about this. People are moving back and forth. 90% of respondents say that they use multiple screens every single day. If we think about our own lives, it's probably true. I think the exception is if you're using mobile phone as your only screen, which is rare these days, especially if you have a desk job, but there are more and more people who are opting to have the mobile phone as their primary and perhaps only device. We know that digital drives people in store and that people are doing research. 87% of consumers, in fact, are doing research before going into a store. And that mobile is the new shopping assistant, right? So 82% of smartphone users will actually use their device to help them make a product decision while they're in store. Now, that means instead of asking a sales clerk, that means that they are opening themselves up to, if they're doing a search engine search, to competitors in the field. So you definitely want to consider that as you think about, you know, how you can reach your customer as they're doing their research. They very well may be at the point of purchase. That's why it's so important to measure across channels and really understand all mobile activity as part of one bigger marketing ecosystem, right? Too many advertisers that I talk to who are still thinking marketing, saying that they need mobile conversions to justify the amount they're spending on mobile marketing. But I would highly recommend finding some sort of system that will allow you to see, okay, for mobile ads that we put out there, are they turning into call center calls? Are they turning into leads but that are being submitted through desktop? Are they turning into in-store visits? Try and take all of these things into consideration when you're trying to quantify the real value and the full value of mobile. And then ultimately, it's really important to think about your own organization and how you can nix team silos. 62% of marketers measure efficiency and effectiveness based on the specific channel or campaign, and far too many marketing departments are still splintered and siloed. So one example of a company that did a really nice thing is Target. And they realized that for its patio furniture category, their marketing team was entirely too siloed. They had the online people competing in a way with the in-store people. And so what they did is they brought everyone together and said, okay, this is the patio marketing organization. And they all worked together, and they were all, their incentives were aligned so that patio furniture, no matter which channel or device the purchase was made through, all was credited back to the patio furniture team. And in-store employees get credit for online sales in their area rather than, misaligning those incentives. And we now know, as a result, multi-channel guests are Target's most valuable customers. Almost 3 times more visits to Target properties, more than 3 times more sales than store-only shoppers. It makes sense to think through how your marketing teams are aligned and if you're working in the same way that your customers are, which is just based on, convenience or what makes the most sense for them at that moment. So I'm going to end with your mobile marketing strategy checklist. So be there, be useful, be quick, and connect the dots, and definitely think through how you can be mobile first, not just because it's a buzzword, but because your customers more than likely are sitting wherever they are right now or standing or walking with their phone on their body or right in front of them. And you want to make sure that when they turn to that phone to look for information, when they have a micro moment, that you're there and providing useful and valuable information and shortcuts to them. So with that, I will open it up to questions.
That's great. Lauren, thank you so much for all of the time. This is fantastic. We do have a few questions that have been coming in. One question was, this is refers to one of the terms that you used in the beginning of the presentation, and this participant wants to know if you could define the term vertical.
Yes, vertical. Okay, so vertical is a subset of an industry. So an example would be like financial services or pharmaceuticals or retail. That's what I mean by vertical.
Okay, great. Another question. So we have someone else who is quite new to this field, and they're wondering if you have any resources that you might be able to offer or any courses that you know of or could recommend to help get someone up to speed.
Ooh, a great question. With regards to courses on mobile marketing, it depends on where you are. I suppose I'm guessing there's plenty of online offerings available. If you're in New York, I know the General Assembly offers lots of technology education. I don't have one that just jumps to mind, but I would certainly, you know, when I'm in doubt about anything, even including for my day job, I just Google it. So I would certainly recommend, you know, doing a search of seeing what's in your area or what's available online.
Okay, great. Another question, Lauren, where do you see mobile marketing or where do you predict it going next? We've seen it, as you had mentioned, with banking and online deposits, mobile deposits. We're seeing a boom in grocery shopping apps, everything from Box.com to Jet.com, Amazon. We're seeing apps that can be used in stores when you go into Starbucks to get a cup of coffee or when you want your salad at Sweetgreen. Where else do you see mobile marketing going in the next, you know, few months to a few years out?
Yeah, you mentioned this a little bit, but I see it just jump. We're reaching the inflection point when it comes to payments in apps. I now, as I mentioned in the beginning, I'm starting to pay through more and more branded apps. For like food or other sundries that I'm getting, and so I'm seeing that as a jumping off point. Google Wallet has been around, as has Apple Pay, for several years, but I personally just started using some functionality of Google Wallet, which is the ability to send and receive money through email. So I think that the relationship between currency and the smartphone is definitely going to be a theme of the next several months and years. You hear of sort of wunderkind apps like Venmo that's really taken off with a certain younger demographic. But I think you're going to start seeing a lot of companies try and get into that space, even if it's, you know, your local salad company saying just pay on your phone, leave the wallet at home.
Okay, great. A few more questions here too. Can this participant wants to know if we can restrict the ads location to pop up in Google searches in special areas?
Absolutely, yes. Geotargeting is completely possible. What's a little bit tougher is a very specific type of geotargeting called geofencing. I've heard of some third parties that do offer geofencing, as in the ability to serve a certain ad in micro locations, like in certain parts of a department store or within 1 mile of an airport, things like that. But in general, geotargeting, as in within 5 to 10 miles of a certain location, is certainly available and has always been through Google AdWords, including on mobile phones.
Okay, great. Another question. This one has to do with nonprofits, which is really excellent. Wanting to know, do you see, in quotes, a donate button coming for nonprofits to be used with mobile applications?
Ooh, that's a great question. You mean within the nonprofits app?
Yes.
Potentially, yeah. I see no reason why not. I think that's a great idea. Anything with those big touchable buttons that fits within, the design scheme of an app would be a great idea. If the question is more about Google search and do I see there being, you know, that quick, just like you can tap once to make a phone call or tap once to download an app, tap once to donate, I'm not sure that I've seen that come through on any roadmaps, but, you never know, and it's a good suggestion.
Okay, great. Lauren, another one for you. If you are a new company, obviously in terms of online presence, the priority being coming up with a website that is sleek and one that that downloads quickly, that moves at a fast pace, how soon after that's established should you start considering your mobile presence?
Immediately, or maybe even not in that order. I actually often recommend to advertisers that they have a mobile marketing presence even before their site is perfect. It can take a while to get a really great site and to reduce all those points of friction on a site. I would say don't wait until it's perfect and don't let perfect be the enemy of good. I definitely shared some points about how you can reduce friction on a site, but it can be hard whether you're a new company or an old one. Frankly, it might be easier for a newer company to reduce those points of friction on a mobile site. I work with Fortune 500 advertisers for whom it can take a year plus to change the way a form is filled out on a site. So actually take pride in the fact, if you're a new company, that it may be easier for you to make to be agile and to make some adjustments on the go. But have a mobile presence no matter what. One thing we do offer, Google offers, if your site is in no condition to be promoted, if your mobile experience is really subpar and you don't want to offer a poor brand experience, you can run what's called a call-only ad, which is you can still participate in the mobile search results with a call-only ad that will not actually drive to your website, but will allow someone to call you directly from the search results on mobile phones.
Oh, wow, that's really excellent. That is a great piece of advice. I think that is it for now. We don't seem to have any other questions coming in, but I did just want to remind everyone that's participating that you are going to be emailed the slide deck from Lauren's presentation that includes the links, and you're also going to be receiving notification when this goes live on the YouTube site. So it will include both the slide deck and the audio. So this entire presentation, as recorded today, will be available in just a few days. So I just would like to thank everyone for participating. Lauren, we thank you again for your time and for coming back to your alma mater to give us some insights on mobile marketing.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for having me. It was my pleasure.
Have a wonderful afternoon, everyone.